Good morning and welcome to the worship of God here at our virtual gathering for Danville Congregational Church. We are so glad that you're able to join us here this morning. We are an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ. We're a people of extravagant welcome. No matter what you look like, talk like, sing like, move like, dress like, vote like, or love like, you are welcome here. And indeed, we are glad that you are here with us this morning. If you're new to our community, we invite you to say hi in the lower right-hand corner of the screen. There's a chat box there. We invite you to introduce yourself if you feel comfortable. And a member of our community will welcome you to this gathering. We have a couple announcements this morning. The first is that you can always follow along with the service by going to our website, danvillechurch.org/bulletins, and you can follow along with the online bulletin this morning. We have a few upcoming gatherings happening this week via Zoom. We have our youth group tonight at 5 p.m. We have our midweek devotional on Wednesday at noon, and then our family devotional Wednesday at 7 p.m. for families of all configurations. And so we hope that you will take the time to join us midweek at one of these two gatherings. And if you have a youth in grades 6 through 12, they're invited to join Pastor Todd for youth group at 5 p.m. If you have prayer requests for worship that come up for you throughout the week, you're invited to send those directly to me at eric@danvillechurch.org. Later in the service, we'll have an opportunity to name our joys and our concerns through the chat box window. And so later in the service, you're invited to type in your joy or concern, and Pastor Todd will be sure to lift that up in our time of worship this morning. Heidi, would you like to make an announcement about our annual meeting? I'm going to unmute you.
I just want to remind everyone that immediately following service today, that we will be having our annual meeting. We will be conducting all the votes online, utilizing the chat room, as we did a couple of weeks ago when we had a congregational meeting. So I'm sure we'll get a 5-minute break between the sermon and or the service and our meeting, or I'm asking for a 5-minute break. I'll need one. Again, please stay on board after the service, and we'll start our annual meeting. Thanks, Todd. Or no, Eric, wherever you are.
Thank you. Beloved friends, this is the day that our God has made, and so let us rejoice and give thanks for it. I'm going to invite Zach Ferber-Dobson to lead us in our call to worship this morning.
Please join me in the call to worship. Raise your voices in response to God's goodness.
We praise you, O Lord, for all the blessings you have given us.
Lift your hearts in sweet surrender to God's mercy.
We thank you, O Lord, for hearing the prayers of our hearts.
God is good. Praise be to God.
The love and mercy of God never fails. Amen.
Please join me in our gathering prayer. God, open our hearts this day to receive your word for us. Give us courage and hope. Amen.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another with waves and smiles and pass the peace of Christ using the chat feature. The gospel of reading for today comes from Romans 5, 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace which we stand, and we boast our hope by sharing the love, sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast into our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character. Character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. May God bless this reading.
Amen, church. You can say amen this way. That's a way we can say it. Thumbs up. And hope does not disappoint. Thank you, Hazel, for bringing these words to us today. So I'd like to spend the next couple of minutes with a message for our young people. We usually call this our time with children. It is not, however, restricted to just children by age, but to those of us who might be children at heart. I see Fiona there. So Fiona's someone who grew up in this church and was an actual child in our church and is a child at heart in our church. So we're glad. I just want to look through the room and see who's here. I didn't get to do that. Good to see so many families gathered together. Hey, Piper, how are you? The scripture that we're going to talk about today is kind of complicated, as Pastor Eric mentioned in his email, this notion of rejoicing in our suffering or the challenges that we face. I wonder if anyone in the Zoom knows how to ride a bike. Raise your hand or wave if you know how to ride a bike. Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, everybody. Awesome. So did you all just get on the bike one day and be like, okay, I'm going to ride a bike, and just off you went? I didn't. How many of you fell a few times or a lot of times? I even chipped a tooth on the street because I fell on my bike trying to learn to ride my bike. And so I was thinking about that as challenge that even though we kept falling, we, most of us, got up and tried it again. And now what do we remember? We remember how hard we worked to ride that bicycle. And maybe not so much that we fell and hurt ourselves or skinned our knees or broke our tooth, but that we learned to ride that bike. Some of you know that Miguel and I like superhero movies. We know they're not real, but it's fun to pretend. How many of us maybe pretended we were Superman or Wonder Woman when we were kids or something like that? So I happen to remember a movie clip from one of the latest Marvel movies, Captain Marvel, the one that featured a female-identified superhero for a change. And there's a scene in that movie, and I just want to, okay, and I know that superheroes and all that's not real, but I think this clip shares maybe an interesting perspective on what it means to think about the challenges that we've been through. So I'm going to share that short video clip with us now. So I don't know about you, but what this video clip makes me think about is the things in my life that maybe have been difficult or that were challenging, like when I wrecked my bike and fell and broke my tooth, what I remember about that is, while I remember that I broke my tooth, I remember, and maybe you do too, that I still got back on my bike and I learned to ride it. And so I don't rejoice that I broke my tooth, but I rejoice that I learned through some challenges, maybe some suffering, how to ride that bike. And so my encouragement to our young people, to our children, to all of us is, when we are going through difficult conversations, when we are trying to learn something new or a new way of learning, maybe we can remember that those things that challenge us sometimes make us stronger. So I hope that this word has been encouraging to you as we look forward to the word that Pastor Eric will continue. So let's pray together for just a moment and invite you to pray and repeat after me if that feels comfortable to you. Dear God, thank you for this beautiful day.
Thank you for this beautiful day.
Thank you for our church family.
Thank you for our church family.
And that we can still gather together. We thank you for helping us be strong.
We thank you for helping us be strong.
And we pray,
and we pray
that you help us learn from our challenges.
That you help us learn from our challenges.
And grow stronger.
And grow strong.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
And as we prepare to enter this time of spoken word and reflection, I invite us now into a moment of prayer. Let's pray together. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on each one of us, wherever we might find ourselves in this world. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts together be acceptable and pleasing to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. On Monday, May 25th, George Floyd was killed by violent police. Floyd's murder is not an isolated single event, but follows a long litany of police brutality in our country against Black and Brown people, particularly Black men. The events that have followed Floyd's murder, nationwide protests, demands for justice, but also continued violence, destruction, police brutality, and systemic racism, make today a very hard day to preach. We were called into worship this morning with the following words read by Zach. Raise your voices in response to God's goodness. We praise you, O Lord, for all the blessings you have given us. Lift your hearts in sweet surrender to God's mercy. We thank you, O Lord, for hearing the prayers of our hearts. God is good. Praise be to God. The love and mercy of God never fails. This call to worship is an adaptation of Psalm 100, a psalm of praise and thanksgiving. The psalm or psalter reading assigned in the liturgical calendar for Sunday, June 14th, the second Sunday after Pentecost. Now, at first, being called into worship this morning by this psalm, after the week we've experienced, it honestly just doesn't seem quite right. I can't decide if I loved it or if I hated it. I can't decide if it was disingenuous or not. Psalm 100 is all about praising and thanking God. It begins with, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing. on Tuesday of this past week, I hated this psalm. How can we make a joyful noise to the Lord when we are in the midst of a global pandemic that has had us sheltered in place for 3 months now, which has killed over 100,000 people in the United States and close to 500,000 people globally? How can we make a joyful noise to the Lord when our nation witnessed police kill an unarmed black man named George Floyd and another family that grieves the loss of a dad? How can we make a joyful noise to the Lord when we continue to witness sustained nationwide protests over the killing of black people by police? How can we make a joyful noise to the Lord when two more black trans women of color, Rhea Milton and Dominique Fells, were killed this past week? And how can we make a joyful noise to the Lord when we are confronted, perhaps like never before, with our own roles and how our complicity perpetuates the sin of white supremacy in our country? How can we make a joyful noise? But then on Wednesday, I woke up in the morning and I loved Psalm 100. On Wednesday, I opened my email and I read an email from one of you. Your email reflected on the power of last Sunday's service that we all experienced here in this virtual space. You were moved so much by the voices of the Black community that you felt compelled to reach out to your company's CEO because of the lack of clear anti-racism messaging that was coming out of your company. This message was a needed reminder to this pastor that the work that we do matters and that this community is making a difference in your life and the lives of many within our congregation. And so after I read your email, I thought to myself, Eric, how can you not make a joyful noise at such a time as this? How can you not say God is good when a member of your congregation steps out of their comfort zone and stands up to advocate for clear anti-racism messaging in their personal and professional life? How could I not say God is good? These people are getting it. They're really getting it. The Holy Spirit is at work among us. The Holy Spirit is calling us to do this really hard introspective work so that we may become an anti-racist people, an anti-racist church. Yes, God is good. And then Friday happened. Friday happened, and I hated Psalm 100 again. Friday, June 12th, was the fourth anniversary of the Pulse nightclub mass shooting, where 49, primarily LGBTQ and Hispanic people, were targeted and killed by a gunman in Orlando, Florida. And I was reminded, and as I was reminded of the Pulse anniversary, and in my moment of grief, I also received a news notification on my phone that the current administration finalized a rule that would remove non-discrimination protections for LGBTQ people when it comes to healthcare and health insurance in our country. It's one of the many rules and regulations that's been put forward by this administration that defines sex discrimination as only applying when someone faces discrimination for being female or male. And it doesn't protect people from discrimination on the basis of their orientation or their gender identity. And so, my friends, I once again wondered, how can I speak the words of the psalmist? Make a joyful noise to the Lord. God is good. When the dignity and the worth and the protection of LGBTQ people, particularly our trans siblings, are continually violated and threatened by the people we elect in this country to keep us safe. Friends, such a week as this makes it very hard to preach to you. I hope you understand this. I really did not want to do it. The weight of the world is bearing down on me. For every good piece of news that I get, there is that much more bad news. I wasn't sure what to say. I'm still a little unsure as to what to say. What can I possibly say about the collective human suffering of our world in a moment like this? All I can do is lead to where I was led. And here is what happened to me this week. I logged into Facebook. Yes, I logged into Facebook, and I saw this image that Pastor Todd is going to put on the screen for you. In this image, albeit a cartoon depiction of Jesus with a herd of sheep, I was reminded that God comes to find us in our suffering, in the places where we may be lost, in the moments where we are simply just trying to hang on to the edge of that cliff, when we are that one sheep that has been lost, that has been forgotten, divided or separated from the herd. God leaves the whole herd behind, everything behind, to find that one sheep. God comes and finds us. When the world is dark, when the bad news outweighs the good news, God comes to be with us. We read in Paul's letter to the Romans that we are to boast in our suffering. We are to boast in our suffering, Paul says, which sounds utterly ridiculous as I reflected in the weekly message that goes out on Thursdays, until we remember that it's in our suffering where God meets us. God meets us in our suffering. We see God's solidarity with humanity and the suffering of humanity no more clearly than we do when we look at the cross. God comes to meet us hidden in the human of Jesus, and God suffers and God dies on the cross. And then from death on the cross, we find resurrection. God meets us in suffering and then brings about life from there. God finds us in our suffering, and then God takes our suffering when we are ready, and God uses it to bring hope into the world. In the book of Revelation, we read that God wipes away every tear. It's a much loved reading for funerals and memorials, and that's for good reason. Because you cannot wipe away a tear unless you are close to those who are in pain and are crying. You have to be near them, and you cannot shy away from their pain and their grief. And that is the promise, that God is never far away. Now, I realize that that might not be good enough for some of us gathered here today. Some of us may still hate Psalm 100 today. We might not be ready to make that joyful noise to the Lord. We may not be ready to praise God for God's goodness. We might not be ready to believe in God's love and God's mercy. We might not be ready to boast in suffering. And that's okay. I want you to know that that is okay. But we can cling to the promise that God will meet us in our darkest hour, that God will come and find us and be with us. Friends, it's been a hard week. Heck, it has been a hard year. Good news, bad news, good news, bad news again. So in this moment, I'd like to invite us to be quiet. Let's just take a moment for some silence this morning, wherever you may find yourself. And then after a few moments, I will close us in prayer. Oh God, how can we make a joyful noise and praise you on a week such as this? And oh God, how can we not make a joyful noise and praise you on a week such as this? God, give us the courage to be like Paul, to boast in suffering, to rejoice in whatever it is we are experiencing. Not because it is good that we suffer, not because you cause our suffering, but because you promise to meet us there, to find us there, and to bring hope and life out of there. God, give us eyes to recognize you. Help us to be lovers of you and messengers of peace and hope in the midst of so much sadness and suffering. Amen.
Broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we can walk it out. Ooh, mountains, we can walk it out. Silence isn't quiet, and it feels like it. and we'll rise up.
Amen. Amen, church. Let's see and hear an amen for Gabrielle and John, and also for Pastor Eric. So we come now to our time of prayer. We pray together because we believe in a God that hears God's people. And so this act of prayer, while familiar to us, invites us to participate in a variety of ways. We may pray in the silence of our hearts. We may pray, God, hear our prayers. There be a point in time where I invite you to say prayers out loud, because there's something about naming things out loud. And so, however it is that you are called to participate in this time of prayer together, whether it's typing your joy or your concern in the chat box, whether it's holding those prayer requests in your heart or saying names aloud, you are invited into this time of solidarity through prayer. Holy God, we, your people, join people around the world, gathered to worship you, to find a way to praise your name, to bear witness to one another's joys and concerns and fears. And so, God, we pray these prayers to you now. Christian Chambers reminds us that it is Pride Month, and so we ask a special blessing, God, on all your rainbow-hued children, LGBTQ, wherever they are on the alphabet. We lift them up to you now. God, in your mercy. Nancy Hill requests prayers for Karen Anderson, who is hospitalized with pneumonia and a fractured tailbone. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We want to lift up our young people, all young people in particular, who may be struggling with challenges to their mental health as they continue to be isolated from their peers and from the outdoors and from gathering with other people, particularly youth for whom home is not a safe place. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Maddie and Carol, and I'm sure others, celebrate the beautiful music that we have heard that John and Gabrielle have lifted up to your name. We're so grateful for these gifts and for the gift of music. God, in your great love, hear our prayer. Bill Armstrong expresses gratitude for our prayers and love this difficult week. And always, we love and cherish you all. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Mariah invites gratitude for the prayers for Trevor and his family. He is recovering from his head injury. He has a long way to go, but he is talking and ready to move on to rehab. Thank you all for your continued prayers. God, in your healing and mercy, hear our prayer. Trish asks us to pray for a family member moving through stages of recovery and rebuilding their life. God of new beginnings, God of mercy, hear our prayer. Melissa and Glenice invite prayers for those who risk naming racism in the workplace. May you, God, protect and keep them safe. God, in your mercy and love, hear our prayer. Joanna Meyer Mitchell invites us to hold with her the 12-year anniversary of the death of her mother, Barbara Meyer. God of comfort and mercy, hear our prayer. Kim invites prayers for the staff, families, and board of Dayspring Preschool as we reopen tomorrow. God, in your love and mercy, hear our prayer. Larry invites that we pray for us all to see what we can't see, to keep loving, to forgive each other, and to support each other, including those who are strangers to us. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amy expresses gratitude for the word of Pastor Eric today for providing us with hope based in reality of life's challenges. God, in your mercy and love, hear our prayer. Maddie reminds us to pray for the people that got shot and killed by the police. God, in your mercy, God, we pray this morning for the family of Richard Brooks, who was killed this weekend in Atlanta by police. We, as a congregation, as a community, we say his name, Richard Brooks. We pray this morning for the two Black transgender women who were killed within 24 hours of each other. We say their names together, Dominique Remy Fells. And we say Rhea Milton. And we say Black trans lives matter. God, we remember and hold close the 49 angels whose lives were taken from them by a person with guns in his hands and malice in his heart. We look at their faces. We see the life in their eyes. And we remember that they are someone's son or daughter. And so we say the motto of the people of Orlando. Together we say, we won't let hate win. God, we pray for transgender people. Who in this moment feel betrayed and attacked and vulnerable. And so in this space of prayer, we say trans lives matter. Trans lives matter. God, we think of people in our lives who need healing. I invite you now to say aloud the name of someone who needs healing. God, there are people on our hearts who have passed from this life, people that we miss, people that we long to see again. I invite you in the space of this prayer to say their names aloud. Know that by saying their names aloud, they remain with us, as does our hope of seeing them again. God, as it is difficult to find the words to praise you, we are aware that we have things that we are thankful for, folks we are thankful for. And so in the space of this prayer, I invite you to say aloud, claim it aloud, that which you are thankful for. God, we thank you that you hear the prayers of your people. When things are good, and especially when things are difficult. Holy God, may we rise up and trust that your faithfulness, your mercy, your love endures forever. And as we close our prayer together this morning, we do so in the words of our sibling Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our loving God, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Remember the words of Jesus. It is more blessed to give than to receive. And I invite you this morning to give with a generous heart. And by the way, it's very easy to do. Now that we're in a virtual church service, all you need to do is go to your web browser, whether it be Safari or Chrome, and type in danvillechurch.org. And then you get to click on the donate button right at the top right-hand corner. You can even use your credit card. I've found it far too easy to do lately, so I encourage you to do the same.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, we give these gifts. Please help us transform them into outpourings of love, peace, and justice. Help us bring hope into the world. Amen.
Beloved friends, as you go forth from this place today, go with the confidence to trust in God's gracious love and mercy. Go ready to proclaim good news and to serve our God by caring for others and living the justice of Jesus. Go forth in peace and hope. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Beloved friends, that concludes our worship this morning, and so our service begins in the world. I would like to take this moment to invite our moderator, Trish Moosberger, to get ready for the annual meeting. So I'm going to unmute you.